Unconvicted by Olly Jarvis and read by Jason Doan for Saga Egmont. Everyone charged with a criminal offence shall be presumed innocent until proved guilty according to law. Article 6, paragraph 2 of the European Convention on Human Rights. I have no colour prejudices, nor caste prejudices, nor creed prejudices. All I care to know is that a man is a human being, and that is enough for me. He can't be any worse. Mark Twain. Prologue. Pani Mila was waiting for Jack in the doorway of the parish hall. An elderly Polish woman who helped out at the church and cooked and cleaned for some of the parishioners, including Jack's father. She reminded him of a Russian matryoshka doll.
Thank you for coming, she said. It means very much to the children, meeting people like you.
It's an honour, Jack replied, letting his wig bag roll off his shoulder.
Sorry, but you'll have to speak Polish.
No problem, Jack replied. The chatter ceased as she showed him through into the hall, full of children of all ages sitting on old plastic chairs. It had been over a decade since he'd last sat in those seats.
Everyone, this is Jack Kowalski, Mila began in Polish. He is a defense barrister working in Manchester.
A few sniggers.
Who knows what that means? She asked.
He gets criminals off, said a boy at the back.
The older children broke into laughter. Well, that's certainly one way of looking at it, Jack cut in, using his best Polish grammar. Encouraged by Jack's reaction, the teenager observed,
You're too young to be a barrister.
There were a few smirks. I'm 26. This wasn't going to be as easy as he'd thought. But some of my clients say the same thing. More laughter.
Anyway, said Pani, trying to regain her rhythm. Jack grew up in Moss Side, went to this church, went to Polish school here Saturdays, just like you. Actually, she said with a smile, like you, he no speak English when he start school.
She turned to the guest speaker for confirmation. That's right, Jack replied. The audience was interested now.
Did you find that hard?
Asked a teenage girl.
Yes, it was difficult to fit in. I don't think I ever got over it.
He had struck a chord.
Is that why you became a barrister, had something to prove?
Good question, Jack laughed. You should be the barrister. A grin spread across her face.
Do you have to wear funny clothes?
Asked a younger girl at the front. Yes, I do. Glad of the respite, he pulled the tin from his bag and held up his wig. I have to wear this, he said, tossing it over to the child.
Try it on.
Enjoying the attention, she put it on, making everyone chuckle. A boy put his hand up.
What do you do if they've done some horrible crime, like rape or murder, and you know they're guilty?
Pani Mila winced, but didn't intervene. Jack gave a wry smile. He'd been asked that question 1,000 times.
You only know if they tell you, and then you can't say they're innocent.
But what if you just know? The boy persisted. In your heart. Jack thought for a moment. You carry on.
That must be very difficult, said Pani Mila.
I suppose so, Jack replied. But it hasn't really happened to me yet. Chapter 1.
Come on, you two, it's 7:30.
Natasha Smart's daughters scampered across the landing. They giggled as she patted their bottoms. The girls climbed under their duvets.
Mummy, said Geraldine, the eldest, as she flopped her head deep into the pillow.
I miss Daddy. When can we see him?
I'm not sure, sweetie. Daddy's poorly. When he's better, you can see him.
Does he still love us, Mummy?
Of course he does, sweetie,
Why'd you ask that?
Geraldine's brow furrowed.
Because I saw him. He didn't look poorly.
Where? As soon as she said it, Natasha wished she hadn't sounded so alarmed. Geraldine studied her mother's face with the intuition of youth.
At school, playtime.
Geraldine's words became a whisper, sensing the importance of her secret.
He talked to me through the fence.
What did he say? Her mother whispered back. She thought for a moment.
I can't remember. I think it was about God.
Natasha was still taking this in when she heard something being knocked over outside. The wheelie bin. She got up and looked out of the window, onto the lane below. Too dark to make anything out. She cursed the lack of streetlights. Since she'd separated from Tim, the house had lost its appeal. Once their dream home, the Cheshire farmhouse with its own land, had become a frightening and isolated prison. She finished tucking the girls in, kissed their foreheads, and made her way downstairs. Another clattering sound, this time from the back of the house. Natasha's heart was pounding. She tiptoed through the kitchen to the back door and peered through the glass into the darkness. Nothing. She unlocked the door, opened it slowly, then stood on the step, illuminated by the kitchen light.
Tim, is that you?
The stillness of the countryside filled her with anxiety.
But if you're trying to scare me, it isn't working. Go home or I'll call the police.
After a few seconds, she half turned, about to go back inside. Then something on the patio caught her eye. White paint. Letters. A word. Whore. The shock made her gulp. She slammed the kitchen door, locked it, then ran to the front door to check the bolt. Senses heightened, the slightest sound made her jump. She leaned against the wall and slid to the floor, knees up against her chest. Burying her head in her hands, Natasha began to sob. Chapter 2. Jack tutted when he saw that the light was still on in Mariusz's workshop. He locked the door behind him and flipped the open sign to closed. Tata, you promise not to work this late anymore.
I'm finishing now,
Jack's father replied, getting up from the sewing machine.
Give me hand.
Jack walked past the suit rails and steadied Mariusz as he tried to straighten up. Mariusz waved a finger at the finished jacket. Jack hung it up, switched off the light, helped his father up the back stairs to his flat, and lowered him into the armchair.
You've got to slow down, Tata. You know what the doctor said.
Mariusz gave a disapproving grunt.
Zuppe in fridge. Pani Miller make.
Jack put the soup on the hob. Smells good, he called to Mariusz.
When are you going to take Mila dancing at the Polish club? Stop talking rubbish,
Jack laughed.
She very grateful you agreed to give talk.
I enjoyed it. They asked some tough questions, though.
Jack took the soup through to the lounge. His father made to get up, but Jack gestured for him to sit and pulled a small mahogany effect coffee table over to his chair. Mariusz sipped at the spoon cautiously and watched his son.
You look well, Janusz.
Jack blew on his soup.
I am. I feel like everything's falling into place. Like I'm finally getting the hang of it. I may actually be able to do this job.
Mariusz smiled.
I knew you could.
A pause.
And what about Lara?
I'm on a case with her at the moment. Speeches tomorrow, he replied, knowing what his father really meant.
When you going to ask her on date?
We work together. She's my instructing solicitor. I don't want to spoil things.
Mariusz scoffed.
You have courage to fight case in court, but you too shy to ask her.
Leave it out, Tata. It's not that easy.
There was no hiding from his father.
I will when the time's right.
Chapter 3. Oblivious to the biting Mancunian wind, Jack walked down Key Street with a spring in his step. He stopped outside Chambers, touched his name on the list of members, and smiled to himself. Jack Kowalski was finally a tenant at Century Buildings. He ran up the steps, two at a time, then turned left into the clerk's room.
"Ah, Mr. Kowalski, how are we today?"
asked Bob as he watched Chambers' newest tenant take off his coat. "Fine, thanks. Speeches at 10:30 in my burglary trial." He reached into his pigeonhole. "What's this?"
"It's a bail application and a rape, sir. On the missus. A favour for your old pupil master. Mr. Huntsman's part heard in Liverpool. You'll look after it, won't you?"
Bob's politeness didn't fool Jack. Nobody refused the senior clerk. A rape?
"But you'll be all right, sir. The solicitor is Ken Dobkin. He knows you haven't got a prayer. It's just to keep the punter happy. You're on at 10:00.
"But I need to be done for my trial at 10:30.
"No, it won't take long, sir. Client won't be there, banged up in strange ways."
Jack looked at his watch. "That's in 20 minutes. When am I supposed to read it?"
"Walking to court, of course."
Jack registered his disapproval with a glare.
"Well, get a move on, sir."
"Just this once, then, and only because it's for Mr. Huntsman," said Jack as he left the clerk's room.
"Oh, of course, sir,"
replied Bob, winking at the junior clerks.
"Anyway, you should be thanking me. If you'd had the brief yesterday, you'd have spent all night on it."
Bob got out of his chair and followed Jack as he hurried out onto the street.
"Carry on the way you are, sir, and you'll be doing your own rape trial before you know it."
Turning the corner, Jack raised an arm in triumph. Walking back into the clerk's room, Bob announced,
"I do like that boy."
Chapter 4. Jack robed in double quick time. He rushed down to Court 8, flicking through the brief to take in the basic grounds of the application for bail. He had butterflies. But not for fear of going into court. He'd all but conquered that in his first few months of tenancy. No. He was nervous about being unprepared, and at the possibility of getting a dressing down from the judge. But it was all part of being a barrister, and Jack could handle it. He was on his way. He'd won a few trials. His diary was starting to fill up, and solicitors were actually briefing him in his own name. And most important of all, he was starting to feel comfortable, not only in a wig and gown, but in his own skin. His opponent was already in court. Barry Smith worked in-house at the Crown Prosecution Service, a sensible and fair prosecutor who gave every brief the same meticulous consideration.
"Here he is. Cutting it a bit fine, aren't you, Kowalski?" he said as Jack flung his papers onto an empty lectern on counsel's row.
"Don't even go there," Jack replied. "Look, I've read the basics, Barry. No previous. Denies it completely. Anything else I should know?" "Only that we're really worried about this one." His humour had vanished. "He's gone totally psycho. Flipped out. Smashed up the house and did some pretty strange things leading up to the rape. We really don't want him out there. This brief has got danger written all over it." "Bloody hell, Barry. Whatever happened to innocent until proven guilty?" asked Jack.
"I wouldn't worry, though, mate. I'll never get bail in this."
"All rise." Her Honour, Judge Bedingfield, entered the courtroom and took her seat on the bench. "Yes," she said, not wasting any time. The court clerk stood up. "The bail application of Timothy Smart, Your Honour. Mr. Smith is here for the Crown and Mr. Kowalski defends." "Well, very good. Let's get on with it, gentlemen. I'm anxious not to keep the jury waiting in my trial. What are your objections to bail, Mr. Smith?"
"Quite simply, risk of further offences, Your Honour. The defendant has committed a very serious offence, rape of his estranged wife. He's very unstable.
There's been a pattern of offending all directed towards Mrs. Smart. Harassment, smashing windows, even entering the house uninvited and leaving bizarre and threatening messages on the walls. She's terrified, Your Honour. The prosecutor handed forward some photographs of the lounge, the first of which showed the words "Sin No More," written in 3-foot-high letters along one wall. "Yes, I see," said the judge, looking through the other photos, clearly concerned. "What do you say, Mr. Kowalski?" Jack got stuck in immediately. "Well, there's absolutely no corroboration for any of this, Your Honour. It all comes from Mrs. Smith, only her word. There's no bruising or injury that suggests a forced sexual act." Jack paused to let his point sink in. "Your Honour, as far as the allegations of criminal damage are concerned, it's pure speculation that they were committed by the defendant. There's not a shred of evidence to link him to the offences. No forensics, no eyewitness evidence, and as I understand it, Mrs. Smart did not report any of these matters to the police at the time they were allegedly committed, only later, when she made the allegation of rape." Her Honour raised an eyebrow. "Is that right, Mr. Smith?" "Yes, it is, Your Honour. Mrs. Smart made her reasons quite clear in her witness statement. She didn't want to aggravate matters by involving the police. She was desperately trying to find a way to appease the defendant and resolve matters amicably for the sake of the children. He reacted very badly when she told him she wanted a divorce." The judge nodded. "Yes, I see." Smith continued. "She'd already managed to persuade the defendant to move out some months earlier. Even then, she noticed how his behaviour was becoming more erratic. As far as any lack of injury is concerned, it's well known that it takes the case no further. There is frequently no bruising or other injury where intercourse is forced." "Semen?" said the judge. "None, Your Honour. The defendant suffered from sexual dysfunction during the marriage, unable to ejaculate. There was a partial DNA profile on a vaginal swab, which matched the defendant." Smith sat down. He'd done enough. "Mr. Kowalski?" "I've seen the expert's preliminary report. It's a significantly incomplete profile. My learned friend knows full well that he would never get that in evidence before a jury. Your Honour, Mr. Smith hasn't dealt with a fundamental flaw in the Crown's case. The identification. Mrs. Smart says she woke up to find herself being blindfolded in her bed. Her hands were then tied to the bedposts and she was raped. Even if her account were true, she never saw her attacker's face. How can she possibly identify the defendant?" Barry Smith scoffed as he stood up to respond. "A rather compelling circumstantial case, though, Your Honour. The rapist clearly must have entered with a key. The complainant is adamant that after 10 years of marriage, she knew her own husband when he was on top of her, as well as all the other matters already mentioned. Oh, and when interviewed by the police, the defendant answered no comment to all questions." Jack shot up. "As was his right, Your Honour. The defendant has no previous convictions. He's just an accountant. The prosecution do not have any other independent evidence to put before you today that suggests Mr. Smart is unstable, unpredictable, or criminal." Her Honour looked to Mr. Smith again for an answer. "That is right. Not yet. But the alleged rape happened only last week. The investigation is in its very early stages." Jack finished his submission. "Your Honour will be well aware that a trial date in this matter is likely to be months away. To remain in custody for that length of time will cause immense damage and suffering to this defendant, who, as I say, is of hitherto impeccable character. There is a real danger of prejudging this matter today on the basis of a single witness, Mrs. Smart, who cannot be said to be independent. This case is about a marriage breaking down and all the hidden agendas that inevitably involves." Jack sat down. Smith looked across at him nervously as the judge considered the matter. Finally, she made her decision.
It is with a great deal of hesitation that I will grant bail. There will be conditions of non-contact with the Smart family, residence at the defendant's parents' address in... Mr. Kowalski?
At Withington, Your Honour, as set out in the written application.
And daily reporting to Longsight Police Station.
She looked at Jack earnestly.
If he puts so much as a toe out of line, his bail will be revoked. Is that clear?
Jack nodded. Yes, Your Honour.
I'll rise while the jury are assembled.
She left as quickly as she had entered.
Jack held up his open hands to Barry and shrugged.
He wasn't going to gloat, but it was a big result for him and for Dobkin and Co.
Well done, Jack, said Barry, magnanimous in defeat. I'm not looking forward to telling Natasha Smart.
Chapter 5
Jack and Lara crossed spinning fields towards Marek's restaurant. After getting bail in the rape, they had also secured a not guilty verdict in their burglary trial.
I really didn't expect that, Jack. Great job. Me too. The drinks are on me.
You know Marek will never let you pay. Jack grinned.
Do you ever wonder about your cases?
What do you mean? Lara replied.
When they get off.
Whether they did it. Lara looked at Jack curiously.
Never. Why waste the energy?
Well, now that I'm actually winning a few, only Jack Kowalski could find the negatives in getting a not guilty, Lara said with mock exasperation. Jack laughed.
Anyway, what's brought this on?
Well, just something I was asked last night by some kids. Lara stopped, grabbing his arm.
The moment you start thinking like that, Jack, you're finished as an advocate.
He nodded.
Look, this is the system we've all signed up to. It ain't perfect, but we have to trust the jury's verdict or the whole thing collapses.
Yeah, I know. I know.
What's the phrase? Better 100 people go free than one innocent man be convicted.
You're talking about having faith in the process, but you and I both know the verdict often depends more on the ability of the barrister than anything else.
Of course. Just like an operation depends on the surgeon.
You have an answer for everything.
That's why I'm a lawyer, she winked.
Jack laughed. Come on, let's get that drink.
Chapter 6
Knock, knock.
Natasha Smart froze. Silence. After what seemed like an eternity, she heard four loud knocks on the front door. She crept into the hall.
Who is it?
The terror in her voice was obvious. No reply. Then a hissed whisper.
"'Tis I."
She jumped. It had come from behind her. Natasha swiveled round. Her mouth went dry. Fear shot through her body. Smart was standing in the kitchen. Had she forgotten to lock the back door? Natasha was momentarily unable to speak.
What are you doing here?
Only a leer in response.
Get out!
She was shaking in fear.
If a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the Church of God?
Natasha noticed something in his hand. A jerry can. She could smell the fumes.
Oh, God, no, please, I'm begging you.
The soul who sins shall die, he said, wallowing in her horror.
I gave her time to repent, he muttered to himself, but she will not turn away from her immorality.
He splashed the petrol over her. Screaming, Natasha flapped her arms, trying in vain to wipe the liquid off her face, all coordination lost in the panic.
No, please, I beg you!
He pulled out a cigarette lighter and held it out towards her. She stopped. Smart's grin radiated pure evil. In the final moments,
Natasha Smart was calm. Finger on flint. Click.
Chapter 7. Marek ushered Lara and his nephew to some empty stools.
Well? He asked.
Not guilty, the lawyers replied. Jack's uncle plonked 3 Tiskia beers on the bar and declared, "Another victory for Kowalski!" They clinked bottles. "Cheers," said Lara.
"Na zdrowie," replied Marek.
"To Lara," said Jack. "She did all the work. I'm just the mouthpiece. We make a good team."
What does she mean?
Mariusz left his drink and moved off to serve a customer. Maybe now was the time. Filled with confidence from the day's events, he needed to seize the moment. Lara. Before he could go any further, his phone pinged.
It's from Sarah Dale. She needs me to come back to Chambers ASAP.
Sounds like something juicy.
Could be, said Jack, trying to return to his task.
Better not keep your head of Chambers waiting, said Lara.
I've got to get back to the office anyway.
In 2 minds, Jack hovered for a moment.
Well, go on then,
she bossed. The moment had passed.
Chapter 8. Jack went straight to the clerk's room to share his good news. Not guilty in the burg, but also bail in the rape.
But Jack didn't get the reaction he'd hoped for. In fact, he got nothing at all. Just stares.
What is it?
He asked, suddenly feeling unnerved. Sarah Dale, head of Chambers, walked in before Bob could respond.
Jack, have you got a minute? We're in the library.
Jack followed her in. Ken Dobkin, Lara's boss, and Simon Huntsman, Jack's former pupil master, were already sitting at the table.
Sit down, Jack, she said, with uncharacteristic tenderness.
She lowered herself onto the seat next to him.
Timothy Smart has just been arrested for murder. Jack couldn't take it in.
Murder?
Then he felt the blood rushing to his head.
Please don't say his wife.
Sarah nodded.
Arson.
Jack turned white. He made to stand up, but his legs gave way.
You all right, Jack? Said Huntsman, with a steadying hand under Jack's shoulder.
Sarah poured a glass of water. Here, drink this.
What about the children?
They weren't there, thank goodness. They were at their maternal grandmother's place, Dobkin replied. It was a regular thing. They're saying Smart knew that.
Jack brushed Huntsman's hand away as the news began to sink in.
And there I was, wallowing in the result while someone was being murdered because of me.
He shook his head. I'll never forgive myself.
For what? Said Ken Dobkin, unable to disguise his irritation.
Go easy, Ken, said Simon.
Ken ignored him. You had a job to do, and you did it. The fact Smart then murdered his wife has got absolutely nothing to do with you. They just didn't have the evidence to keep him in custody.
Spare a thought for Judge Bedingfield. She made the decision to bail him, said Sarah. I've heard she's in pieces.
Jack felt for the judge, but he knew it didn't absolve him. But Ken Dobkin had more pressing matters to discuss.
Look, I've got to go and do Smart's interview at Bootle Street Police Station in 5 minutes. He'll want the barrister that got him bail. Are you going to take the case, Jack? You'll have a silk to lead you.
Jack looked at Dobkin, speechless.
This is a very important case for my firm. We can't afford to lose the brief.
Tell Smart to go screw himself, said Jack coldly.
Just hang on, said Sarah Dale, trying to prevent tempers escalating. I think Jack is entitled to refuse the brief on the grounds of lack of experience. He's never done any kind of homicide, let alone a murder, and anyway, Simon was instructed on the rape. It should be his brief.
Oh, don't worry about me, said Huntsman.
Sarah glowered at him for his lack of guile.
Jack got up.
I'm sorry, but this isn't why I came to the bar. Nothing seemed to matter anymore, except what he'd done. I'm going home. Dobkin shook his head at Jack. Whatever happened to innocent until proven guilty? Jack wasn't in the mood for platitudes. Sarah was more understanding as they followed Jack out.
All right, have a few days off. Get your head together.
Thanks. Jack walked out of chambers, unsure whether he would ever return. Chapter 9.
No, I'm so sorry, please.
Jack Kowalski woke with a start. Sitting bolt upright, he surveyed his bedroom, then wiped the sweat from his forehead. He dropped back onto the bed, eyes fixed on the ceiling. Another night of broken sleep and haunting dreams. It was the same every morning. Exhaustion, made worse by a hangover. Why did it have to be Jack? Why couldn't someone else have made that bail application? Did he try too hard? He should have realized he was acting for a psycho. There was blood on his hands. He rolled over and tried to lose the old thoughts. He was spiraling into a deep depression, which he knew he might never recover from if he didn't get a handle on it soon. Energized by fear of where he was heading, Jack got up and walked into the kitchenette. He filled a saucepan with water and plunked it lazily onto the hob. He took out the only thing in his freezer, a bag of meat pierogi, and poured it into the pan. He missed Lara. It was his own fault. If he wasn't taking on cases, how did he expect to see her? Maybe Jack should have rung her, but what would he have said? She wouldn't want to hear from some needy, failed barrister. If only he could think straight, see through the haze of tiredness and guilt. His phone rang. Chambers. He went to answer it, then, knowing he wasn't ready to go back, pressed divert. Chapter 10. Lauren Riley loved money, but she'd never had much of it. A tough childhood on the Ortel estate had taught her the value of things. She was young and easy on the eye. Her tanned and toned legs propped up the bar every Saturday night at Ambrose, one of Manchester's most popular nightclubs. Lauren rarely had to buy her own drinks. She scanned the room, looking for a potential partner for the night. Not the no-marks that had been buying her woo-woos all evening. She took another gulp and slammed the empty glass down on the bar. She was on a mission to get pissed. Hello, Lauren. How's the world of glamour? A man had squeezed in next to her at the bar. He wasn't wearing the right gear to be an Ambrose regular. Lucky to get in, she thought. Must have bribed the door. She'd had dealings with him before. It's quiet, she replied. I'll have a vodka Red Bull, tar. He ordered it and a bottle of Beck's for himself. You need to get yourself in the tabloids, love, he suggested. She looked at him as if he was stupid. Well, yeah, page 3 would be a start. Twat. He didn't appreciate being spoken to like that. He touched her hair, just to show her who was in charge of the transaction. I love blondes, me. Is that your natural colour? She flicked his hand away. Piss off. Then curiosity got the better of her. What do you want, anyway? It's your lucky night, Lauren. He picked her clutch bag up, off the bar, and placed a roll of cash inside. She said nothing. There's a footballer over there, Lauren, in the VIP bit. Very green. United's next big thing. I want you to fuck his life up. She glanced over and smiled for the first time in ages. Don't mind if I do. Chapter 11. PC Adil Khan checked his watch as he drove. It would be another late finish, just so the prickly DS could have a chauffeur from some dinner at the town hall. "Slow down a second, Daddy," asked DS Joan Baker. "You see that girl there?"
"Oh, yeah, too right," he replied. "Quite a looker."
The girl was half walking and half running down Deansgate. She wore a skimpy, figure-hugging white dress, no shoes. "There's something not right. Adil, pull over."
"Yeah, hammered, probably."
"Just pull over, will you?" she said, with a hint of irritation.
"Yeah, all right, all right,"
PC Khan replied. They pulled up alongside the young woman. At first, she didn't notice them. DS Baker called out, "Is everything okay, love?" The girl saw them now. She stopped, then walked straight to the police car, opened the door, and got in the back seat. She was shaking. They could see marks, possibly burns, on her wrists.
"It's all right. You're safe now."
"What's your name, love?"
asked Baker above the crackle coming from their radio.
The girl stared blankly back at her. Her face was a mess, the bruising made worse by the smeared lipstick and smudged eyeliner. DS Baker turned to her colleague. "She's in shock, poor thing." She tried again. "We're going to take you somewhere comfortable, okay, love?" No reply. "What's your name, sweetheart?" Eventually, in a whisper, "Lauren." Her bottom lip began to quiver.
"I've been raped."
DS Baker sighed. "I know, love. I know."
Chapter 12.
Marek's restaurant was full. Jack's piano playing was a big pull. Nobody played Chopin like him. Not in these sorts of establishments. He'd just come to the end of a mazurka.
"Hello, sir."
"Bob?" Jack led his clerk over to an empty booth in the corner of the restaurant. "Do you want a drink?" Jack asked. Bob ignored the offer.
"I wanted to see how you were."
"Thanks, Bob. I'm getting there, just been struggling to get my head around things."
"Yeah, I get it. But I'll be straight with you.
Time's running out."
"What do you mean?" "You're getting a reputation. They're saying you're burnt out. That you were too sensitive for this job. Too..."
He paused. Jack finished the sentence. "Too weak." Bob looked away awkwardly. His words hurt, but maybe they were right.
"Look, Jack," he said in a more avuncular tone, "I've got a great case for you. To get you back with a bang."
He waited for a flicker of interest. Jack couldn't resist.
"What is it?" "A rape."
Jack scoffed.
"Now hang on, hear me out. You're ready for this, Mr. Kowalski. You've done a few trials now, and one very big one."
Bob waited a few seconds to give his offer the appropriate build-up.
"It's a footballer from Poland, a private payer. I bet your overdraft could use it. Some gold digger has played him, apparently."
Jack still wasn't biting.
"He's innocent. Green as they come. Only 18.
"What's his name?"
"Gustav something."
"Not Gustav Novak?"
"That's the fella. You heard of him?"
"Every Pole has. He's the next big thing."
"Well, you're the only Polish criminal barrister in the area. Did you know that? He wants you. Doesn't trust the locals."
"I was born here, Bob."
"I know, but you don't have to advertise that."
"I wouldn't be able to speak Polish with him, though. It wouldn't be fair on the solicitor. We'd need an interpreter."
"Oh, no problem. He speaks English." "So, you'll do it then?"
"No, I didn't say that. And anyway, this is way out of my league."
"Of course it ain't. You can handle it."
Jack wasn't convinced.
"Well, you've got a couple of days max. Then they're going elsewhere. Don't let me down, Mr. Kowalski."
As Bob got up from the table, he nearly bumped into an attractive, glamorous-looking woman in her 50s. He quickly got over his surprise at the eminent visitor.
"Evening, Judge. Maybe you can talk some sense into him."
He looked back at Jack.
Call me, day or night.
The word judge made Jack spin round. It was Her Honour, Judge Bedingfield.
Hello, Judge, said Jack.
Call me Mary. Do you mind if I sit down? She asked, without waiting for a reply.
No, please do, Mary.
Are you dining here tonight?
No, I came to see you.
Me? She sighed.
Yes.
I was told I'd find you here.
It's my uncle's place, so I help out occasionally.
And you're pretty good on the piano, I'm told. Jack wasn't used to compliments, especially coming from a judge. He didn't know quite how to act or what to say.
How are you, Jack?
Honestly?
Honestly.
His shoulders dropped.
Not great. I've been in a tailspin. Multiply that by 10. That's how I feel.
I'm really sorry.
You have nothing to apologise for.
You just made a bail application perfectly properly. You did your job. I made the decision to bail him. The wrong decision, as it turned out.
I screwed up. She shrugged.
But what can I do, other than live with it? Jack was comforted by her words of wisdom.
You know they had me back in court the next day.
Really? Said Jack.
I'm just a civil servant, after all.
You know what my partner told me, to make me feel better?
What?
She said I could refuse bail in every application that comes before me. Then this would never happen again.
Jack smiled. He'd forgotten Judge Bedingfield was the first openly gay woman on circuit.
But then that would be the coward's way out, because there are plenty of innocent people out there who should get bail. We can't be afraid of doing what we think is right.
Jack took in what she was saying. He wished he had her strength of character.
I know, but no buts, Jack. We have a responsibility. And you're making me look bad. People are asking why you quit, whether you felt guilty about pulling the wool over my eyes.
You didn't.
Thank you for saying that.
She placed a hand on his, then got up to leave.
I'll see you in court, Jack.
Chapter 13. Friday, 2 p.m., a bright winter's day. A police car raced along Slade Lane in Longsight with its siren blaring. A 999 call had been made only minutes earlier. A disturbance, probably a burglary, reported by a neighbour. If the police got to the house quickly enough, they might catch the perpetrator. It was the least they could do when the caller was prepared to leave a name. Two squad cars arrived simultaneously. The front door was open.
Mr. Ross, it's the police. Are you in? Is everything all right?
An officer called out as they searched the small terraced house.
Out here,
called a young PC from the back garden. The other bobbies joined him. An elderly man was lying on his back on the patio, unconscious. There was a pool of blood under his head. Close by, a few of the paving slabs had been removed, where someone had dug a hole.
Poor sod, said one of the officers, as he bent down to tend to the old man. In broad daylight.
Get an ambulance and forensics. Someone was making herself known at the front door.
Hello? Excuse me? Hello?
PC Adil Khan took control.
Mick, you stay with him. I'll deal with this.
He walked back through the house, hoping nobody would notice his muddy footprints all over the carpet. A crowd was gathering outside. An elderly woman peeked nervously into the hallway.
Is he all right, officer? I live next door. It was me who phoned.
Oh, I see. Is it Mrs. Padgett? Asked PC Khan, remembering his community policing manners. He was a good bobby, old school. He knew most people in the area and they knew him. It had taken years to earn their respect and even, some would say, their trust. People would talk to him, tell him things that often proved very useful. Not that his superiors seemed to notice, or if they did, they didn't give him any recognition.
Yes, I heard shouting coming from the back. I knew something was wrong. Was it a burglar? Is Mr. Ross all right?
The officer sought to reassure her as best he could. We don't know very much yet, Mrs. Padgett, I'm afraid. There's an ambulance on its way.
Oh, dear. Did they hurt him? I saw someone.
The crowd was growing, and a few eavesdroppers began to surround them. One disgruntled resident piped up. He'll be long gone by now. Got here too late, as usual. When are you lot going to start catching these tow rags, eh, officer? PC Khan steered the old woman into the front garden as he replied,
Yes, thank you for that, sir. We do our best.
Turning back to Mrs. Padgett, I'm sorry, madam. You were saying that you saw someone.
Yes, about 15 minutes ago.
He ran to the back of Mr. Ross's garden, climbed over the fence and away. Can you describe him?
I suppose I can,
she replied, unsure of herself.
A normal-looking teenager.
What colour was he?
Oh, I see. Black, I think.
PC Khan took out his pocket notebook and wrote this down, without commenting on the vagueness of the description.
He caught his trousers on the fence, so I saw his face when he turned back to pull them free.
Encouraged, Khan asked, Would you recognise him again?
Oh, I should think so, she replied.
Chapter 14. There was a buzz around the courtroom. Half Manchester's legal profession was packed in, all keen to hear the verdicts. This defendant had a lot to lose. Nobody could remember a QC being on trial before, and such an eminent one. Onlookers kept stealing glimpses of him in the dock, transfixed by the sight. He seemed so different now, a shadow of his former self. Lara Panassai, the newly qualified solicitor at Dobkins, took her seat in the public gallery. Today, it wasn't business. It was personal. Jim Smith from the Manchester Evening News caught Lara's eye as he jostled the other journalists and reporters for a place. You okay, Lara?
Yeah, not bad, she said, matter-of-factly, though her anxiety was obvious.
What do you think, then? He asked her. I really couldn't call it, Jim.
All rise.
The chatter ceased as the judge entered the courtroom.
I want absolute silence as the verdicts are delivered. I hope I make myself clear.
The jury was ushered into court.
Would the defendant please stand? Asked the court clerk.
Lionel Catterman, QC, got to his feet. Wide-eyed, even he couldn't conceal his emotions. Guilty verdicts would mean disgrace, jail, oblivion.
Would the foreman please stand?
A studious-looking gentleman in the front row of the jury box stood up. Lara clasped her hands and closed her eyes. She wanted justice.
The court clerk asked the first question. Have you reached verdicts in relation to both counts on which you are all agreed?
We have.
On count one, how do you find the defendant?
Lara held her breath.
Not guilty.
Gasps.
On count two, how do you find the defendant?
Not guilty. Everyone in the gallery turned to the dock. For a split second, Catterman wore a barely perceptible smirk. Lara opened her eyes and saw Catterman looking back at her. She was sure he was laughing to himself. She got up and walked out of court. His Honour thanked the jury for their consideration of the case, then turned his attention to the defendant, addressing him by his full title.
Mr. Catterman, Queen's Counsel, you may be discharged.
The judge smiled, approving of the verdicts.
And I would like to make it quite clear, Mr. Catterman, you leave this court as you entered it, without a stain on your character.
He'd got away with it. He'd bullshitted the lot of them. Lionel Catterman, QC, was back. Chapter 15.
PC Khan parked the squad car just around the corner from Woodford House. There was no point alerting the whole neighbourhood. The offender managers didn't like the police parking outside. It wasn't good for their reputation, and it fueled community opposition to such establishments. Khan had huge respect for these key workers. For very little pay, they gave everything to try and keep young criminals out of jail and steer them away from an empty life of drugs and crime. On a minuscule budget, Woodford House gave apprenticeships to young offenders. It was a thankless task, with most apprentices reoffending, sometimes even while on the course, but every now and then a kid was saved. Khan walked through the garage to the office. The lads were in overalls, working on the cars. The ones that didn't know him made oinking noises as he wove through the garage. Those that did ignored him. Khan had already seen the suspect, but he wasn't about to burn any bridges with Jammer by not speaking to him first. Jammer was in his office, standing up and pleading into the phone. "Well, thanks, bro," he said, before slamming the phone back into its cradle. He noticed the officer waiting outside his door. "Hey, my man," he said, raising a hand to high-five PC Khan. The officer walked in and awkwardly raised his hand in response. Jammer chuckled to himself as he swept his dreadlocks over his shoulders. They had a mutual respect. Both cared about the young people of Levenshulme. After all, they'd grown up there. "Pull up a chair, bro!" Khan obliged. He wasn't looking forward to this. Jammer sat down and leaned in towards his old friend. "What can I do for you, Adil?" "Afraid I've got to arrest one of the lads." Jammer's jocular demeanour switched immediately to disappointment. "What for?" "Burglary and GBH with intent. It's nasty. The victim's in hospital." Jammer had to ask. "Who?" "Gary Dixon." The key worker sat bolt upright. "No, there must be some mistake, not Gary." "Do you know how ridiculous that sounds? He's got form for it." Jammer didn't reply, just shook his head. "You can't save them all, Jammer." Jammer was already thinking about what could be salvaged. "But Adil, he finishes the course in a few weeks. He's my best apprentice. He's even got a job lined up. Will you bail him so he can finish the course at least?" Khan shrugged. He admired Jammer's loyalty to his boys, but there wasn't anything he could do. "That's not up to me," he felt compelled to add. "But I'll put in a good word." They walked out to the garage. Khan found the noise intimidating. Metal on metal and rap on the radio. The teenagers were levelling friendly abuse at each other. Jammer turned off the music. "Gary, come over here, please." A scrawny black teenager pulled his head out from under the bonnet of a Ford Galaxy. On seeing Khan, his expression bristled with attitude. Khan noticed the lad's fingernails, brown from engine oil and grease. Some of the apprentices started to protest. "What's he doing here?" "Mind your own and get back to work," Jammer replied, his authority commanding immediate silence. Khan pulled out his handcuffs and took Dixon's wrists. "Gary Dixon, I'm arresting you for assault and burglary. You do not have to say anything, but anything you do say, mate..." "Yeah, I know," he interrupted, resigned to his fate. Too ashamed to look at his mentor, he could only manage a mutter. "I'm sorry, Jammer." "Come on, son." PC Khan led Dixon out of the garage, ignoring the menacing stares of his comrades. Perhaps he should have brought another officer along, but that wasn't his style. Jammer went back to the office and made a call. "Hello, Lara. It's Jammer from Woodford House. Can you get down to Longsight Police Station?" Chapter 16. Jack let himself in. He still had a key. He called out from the bottom of the stairs that led up to his father's flat.
Tata?
There was no reply. Mariusz was sat in his armchair, asleep, glasses perched on the end of his nose and a thimble on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.